you before. I'm Neil Cox.
Adam Buckwich.
Nice to meet you, Adam. Where are you coming from?
Timpson.
Are you visiting today? Or?
Yeah.
That's cool. Nice to... Is this your first time here, then?
Came here...
The one in the
99? Oh, 99. Nice. I had a girlfriend.
A while ago, huh? Yeah. That's long before I came, so... Yeah. That's cool. What do you do out in Timpson?
I mean, that's where I live. I work here in town, though.
Oh, you work here in town?
Pilgrims.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Pilgrims Pride.
Yeah, yeah. To say welcome.
Thank you.
I hope you have a good time.
Thank you.
We'd like to thank Sister Angie Nicholas for the beautiful prelude music which she played, and for her and Sister Muse doing our music today. We'd like to acknowledge that Brother McAvoy with the State High Council is with us today, and he has some state businesses he will need to take care of. On September 10th is a Religious Freedom Fireside, 6 to 8 here at the Church of the Broadcast. I also understand that we just have to do that. We changed it. The broadcast is 6 to 8 here at the church. We will broadcast it here in the chapel, and I believe we'll broadcast it in Spanish elsewhere. We'll begin by singing hymn number 267, How Wondrous and Great, after which Brother David Hughes will give our invocation. Now I'll turn the time over to Brother McAvoy for some state business.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Sister Muse, would you stand, please? Sister Angela Muse has been called as a home study seminary instructor in the Nacogdoches First Ward, and we propose that she be sustained. Those in favor, please manifest it by the opposing hand. Any opposed? By the same side. Thank you. We have one item of board business. We have called Brother Armando Tejada to be the assistant scoutmaster, and we propose that he be sustained. Those in favor may manifest it by the uplifted hand. Those opposed, if any, may manifest it by the same side. Thank you. We'll proceed to the sacrament portion of our meeting by singing hymn number 180, Father in Heaven, We Do Believe, after which the sacrament will be administered by the members of the Aaronic priesthood.
Thank you. they may eat in remembrance of the body of thy Son, and witness unto thee, O God, the eternal Father, that they are willing to take upon them the name of thy Son, and always remember him, and keep his commandments which he has given them, that they may always have his Spirit to be with them. Amen.
Thank you.
We'd like to thank the members of the Aaronic Priesthood for the reprimand and receive ministry of the sacrament and now dismiss and receive their families. Our first speaker today will be Sister Chrissy Proctor. After Sister Proctor's remarks, we'll hear from Sister Michelle Allen. After Sister Allen, we will sing hymn number 2623, Go Forth with Faith. After our intermediate hymn, we'll hear from Brother Reagan.
I was asked to give a talk on faith. I looked up the definition of faith and it said faith is the complete trust or confidence in someone or something. In the October 2015 General Conference, Sister Melinda S. Reeves said, many in today's world are looking for instant gratification and instant knowledge on the internet. In contrast, we will be exceedingly blessed if we exercise faith and patience and go to our Heavenly Father, the source of all truth, with our concerns. If you're not increasing your faith, you're decreasing it, then we need to be constantly enduring to the end so our testimonies can be strengthened day by day. So I don't know how many of y'all watch the Olympics, but me and Landon would watch the Olympics a lot this past summer, and they had this event that was a 10,000 meter dash or something like that, which is 25 times around the track. And as me and Landon were watching, there's this guy, and he was on lap three, and somehow he like tripped and totally like face planted into the ground, and me and Landon were just like, oh, well, there he's not gonna get a medal or anything. But by the end of the race, he caught up and he actually won first place and got a gold medal. So that probably took him a lot of faith and like endurance, because if I fell, I probably would have just been like, oh, never mind, but yeah. After you make one good choice, it gets easier to make those good choices. But when you start making bad choices, you also get more comfortable making those bad decisions. So we need to stay true to our faith to make it back to our Heavenly Father, and we will be blessed for it. I'd like to end by bearing my testimony that I know this church is true, and I'm grateful for my family and for the missionaries, and as it is in the name of Jesus Christ.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. Today's speakers were asked to talk on faith, hope, and charity. Sister Proctor told us about faith, and my subject matter is hope. Before I get started, I wanted to share with some of my new friends here. A lot of you old friends know who I am. I'm not inactive. I am in the state primary of presidency, and sometimes I'm called away to visit other courts. Nacogdoches Branch is where I grew up, and this week, as I was thinking about Brother Nixon's passing, many of you may know him, some may not, but at one time he was my branch president, and I remember him interviewing me for, I think, baptism in our old branch building over on Longo Street, so I was kind of reminiscing about good times with the Nixon family. My parents and their parents were really good friends. I'm Muse by birth, if you don't know that. Linda Muse is my mother, and Perry Muse is my father. I'm in the middle of five children from the third daughter. And so I was very blessed to grow up in the church. And I've almost always been in the Nacogdoches ward. I left twice, but came back. So after I was asked to speak on hope, I went home and did what probably many of you would do and went to the LDS.org, went to my iPad and my gospel library and searched hope. And there were so many scriptures and so much information, I was having a hard time condensing or trying to decide which direction I wanted to go. So really, for a week, I kind of pondered all those things and then decided how I wanted to go. Let me give you some examples of what I came across in the Old Testament. Psalms 146:5. Happy is he that hath the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. In the New Testament, Romans 8:24-25. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for what we see not, then do we with patience and wait for it. Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the the evidence of things not seen. In the Book of Mormon, Alma 7:24, and see that ye have faith, hope, and charity, and then ye will always abound in good works. Alma 13:29, having faith on the Lord, having a hope that ye shall receive eternal life. Alma 32:21, and now, as I said concerning faith is not to have the perfect knowledge of things. Therefore, if ye have faith, ye hope for things which are seen, which are true. Ether 12:28. Behold, I will show unto the Gentiles their weaknesses, and I will show unto them that faith, hope, and charity bringeth unto me the fountain of all righteousness. Moroni 7:42. Wherefore, if a man have faith, he must needs have hope. For without faith, there cannot be hope. Ether 12:4. Wherefore, whoso believeth in God, might with surety hope for a better world. Doctrine and Covenants 18:19. And if you have not faith, hope, and charity, you can do nothing. Article of Faith 13, portion of it. We believe all things, we hope all things, we have endured many things, and we hope to be able to endure all things. See, you can understand, I was a little overwhelmed about which direction I needed to go until I read this scripture. In 2 Nephi, chapter 31, verse 20. Wherefore you must press forward with a steadfastness in Christ, having a perfect brightness of hope and the love of God and all men. Wherefore you shall press forward, feasting upon the word of Christ, and endure to the end. Behold, thus saith the Father, ye shall have eternal life. So that is what I'm going to focus on, is a brightness of hope. To me, that is, hope was such a cheerful, happy subject. Not in the sense that we think of in this world, but in an eternal perspective. Hope is the confident expectation of and longing for the promised blessings of righteousness. The scriptures often speak of hope as anticipation of eternal life through faith in Jesus Christ. So all this, the research I did, my talk is going to come from a general conference address from L.A. Maxwell, President James E. Faust, LDS.org, and Scriptures. So my understanding of the gospel, the way I think about it, is all gospel principles have to relate back to the plan that Heavenly Father presented for us. This plan has three names: the plan of salvation, the plan of redemption, and the plan of happiness. So I was trying to think, how does hope fit in with this plan that he has for us? So the part of this plan that we're in right now is we're all here in immortal existence. Our time here is very short compared to the pre-mortal and post-mortal life. To illustrate how brief this time on earth is, a long time ago there was a youth fireside speaker that was talking to us and brought in a long string that stretched across the room. And at each end she had a youth hold it and then point as if the string went on for infinitely. And in the middle, she put her finger and thumb and said, this represents your time here on earth, and this is too much. So we have such a short time here to make plans for the next life. So how does hope relate to our time here on earth? Many of us spend our lives looking for something to hold on to, something that will last. We look for ways to avoid aging or become famous or rich, but we eventually realize that mortal life is temporary. Friends and family members grow old and die. The famous are soon forgotten, and wealth is lost as quick as it is won. Our hope and happiness lie in knowing who we are, where we come from, and where we can go. We are eternal beings, spirit children of an eternal God. Our lives can be compared to a three-act play. Act 1, pre-mortal life, before we came to earth. Act 2, mortal life, our time here on earth. And post-mortal life, where we go after we die. God has a plan for our lives since the beginning of the first act. A plan that, if followed, provides comforting guidance now, as well as salvation and eternal happiness in our post-mortal life. The word hope is sometimes misunderstood. In our everyday language, word often has a hint of uncertainty. For example, we may hope for a change in the weather, or a visit from a friend. In the language of the gospel, however, the word hope is sure, unwavering, and active. Prophets speak of having a firm hope and a lively hope. The prophet Moroni taught, "Whoso believeth in God might with surety hope for a better world, yea, even a place at the right hand of God. Which hope cometh of faith, maketh an anchor to the souls of men, which would make them sure and steadfast, always abounding in good works, being led to glorify God." When we have hope, we have faith in God's promises. We have a quiet assurance that if we do the works of righteousness, we shall receive our reward, even peace in this world, and eternal life in the world to come. Mormon taught that such hope comes only through the atonement of Jesus Christ. What is it that you shall hope for? Behold, I say unto you, that you shall have hope through the atonement of Christ and the power of his resurrection, to be raised up, to be raised into eternal life, and this because of your faith in him according to the promise. As we strive to live the gospel, we grow in our ability to abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. We increase in hope as we pray and seek God's forgiveness. In the Book of Mormon, a missionary named Aaron assured him, "I am not king. If thou wilt repent of all thy sins and will bow down before God and call on his name in faith, believing that you shall receive, then shalt thou receive the hope which thou desireth." We also gain hope as we study the scriptures and follow their teachings. The Apostle Paul taught, "Whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that with your patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope." The principle of hope extends into the eternities, but it also can sustain us through the everyday challenges of life. "Happy is he," said the psalmist, "that hath the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God." With hope, we can find joy in life. We can have patience and bear with afflictions, a firm hope that you shall one day rest from all your afflictions. We all have challenges in this life and lots of distractions that keep us from our main purpose or our goal. I don't have to name them for you, but you know, sometimes work can be a distraction that's necessary for us to take care of our family, things that happen in this world. So I was happy to talk about this subject because it is so cheerful and encouraging. Elder Maxwell said, "Unsurprisingly, the triad of faith, hope, and charity, which brings us to Christ, has strong and convergent linkage. Faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ, hope is in his atonement, and charity is the pure love of Christ. Each of the attributes qualifies us for the celestial kingdom. Each, first of all, requires us to be meek and lowly. Faith and hope are constantly interacting, and may not always be precisely distinguished or sequenced. Though not perfect knowledge either, hope's enlightened expectations are with surety true. In the geometry of restored theology, hope has a greater circumference than faith. If faith increases, the perimeter of hope stretches correspondingly. Significantly, those who look to a next and better world are usually anxiously engaged in improving this one, for they always abound in good works. Thus, real hope is much more than wishful musing. It stiffens, not slackens, the spiritual spine. It is composed, not giddy, eager without being naive, and pleasantly steady without being smug. Hope is realistic anticipation taking the form of determination. A determination not merely to survive, but to endure. While weak hope leaves us at the mercy of our moods and events, broadness of hope produces illuminated individuals. Their luminosity is seen, and things are also seen by it. Such hope permits us to press forward, even when dark clouds oppress. Sometimes in the deepest darkness, there is no external light, only an inner light to guide and to reassure. Though anchored in grand and ultimate hope, some of our tactical hopes are another matter. We may hope for a pay raise, a special date, an electoral victory, or a bigger house, things which may or may not be realized. Faith in Father's plan gives us endurance, even amid the wreckage of such proximate hopes. Hope keeps us anxiously engaged in good causes, even when these appear to be losing causes. Hope helps us to walk by faith not by sight. This can actually be safer. When unaided spiritually, natural sight often shrinks from the odds. It is immobilized by improbabilities. Mauled by his moods and intimidated by his fears, the natural man overreacts to while hope overrides the disappointments of the day. Daily hope is vital. Since the winter's quarters of our lives are not immediately adjacent to our promised land either, an arduous trek still awaits, but hope spurs weary disciples on. Those with true hope often see their personal circumstances shaken, like kaleidoscopes, again and again. Yet with the eye of faith, they still see divine pattern and purpose. By pressing forward, we can stand on what was yesterday's horizon, thereby drawing hope from our own experiences. President James E. Faust. Hope is an anchor of our souls. I know no one who is not in need of hope, young or old, strong or weak, rich or poor. As the prophet Peter exhorted, wherefore, whoso believeth in God might with surety hope for a better world, yea, even a place at the right hand of God, which hope cometh of faith, maketh an anchor to the souls of men, which would make them sure and steadfast, always abounding in good works, being led to glorify God. Everybody in this life has challenges and difficulties. This is part of our mortal test. The reason for some of these trials cannot be readily understood except on the basis of faith and hope, because there is often a larger purpose which we do not always understand. Peace comes through hope. The unfailing source of our hopes comes through the knowledge that we are sons and daughters of God and that His Son, Jesus Christ, saved us from death. Hope is an abiding trust that the Lord will fulfill His promises to you. It is manifesting confidence, optimism, enthusiasm, and patient perseverance. It is believing and expecting that something will occur. When you have hope, you work through trials and difficulties with the confidence and assurance that all things will work together for your good. Hope helps you conquer discouragement. The scriptures often describe hope in Jesus Christ as the assurance that you will inherit eternal life in the celestial kingdom. Again, from 2 Nephi, chapter 31, verse 20. Wherefore, you must press forward with a steadfastness in Christ, having a perfect brightness of hope and a love of God in all you. Wherefore, you shall press forward, feasting upon the words of Christ, and endure to the end. Behold, thus saith the Father, you shall have eternal life. Please remember that hope brings comfort. It guards us against despair and discouragement. It is my prayerful wish that we may press forward having a perfect brightness of hope and find peace. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
that the prodigal son who left his home and asked for his full inheritance and took that full inheritance and blew it and was righteous living. The scriptures don't tell us how long it was before he, as the scriptures say, came to himself and realized that he was in a world of hurt and that he desperately needed help. But sure enough, he eventually found himself in that state or condition that really we all have found ourselves in on more than one occasion, and we'll continue to find ourselves in for us to the time we live on the earth. We all hear this parable and it reminds us of different things. Sometimes we relate to the being the father and welcoming home our son. Sometimes we relate to being an onlooker, standing by and watching the whole process and learning lessons from that. Sometimes we relate, as we should, most definitely to the prodigal son himself. We all eventually find ourselves there. For in Romans 3 it says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." I like that. I don't know if it was a bumper sticker or this, some say that Cousin Utor shared, or I think it was on a t-shirt that he saw someone wearing, and he said, "Don't judge me because I sin differently than you." We will all find ourselves there. And in fact, we're all in hell. We desperately need the help of the Savior. We're encouraged when we read on in that parable to read of the exchange between that prodigal son and his father. That's in the 15th chapter of Luke, and it says, "And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Without hesitation, his father saw him and was overwhelmed, excited to see his son coming home. He warmed him with open arms, and it says he kissed his neck." Now, why is this passage of scripture so meaningful to us? I think it gives us a sense of hope for the pure love of Christ that we can look forward to experiencing. Because we can relate to it. I think we can relate to that and have similar experiences as we have repented of our sins and felt that warm reception of the Savior and of our Father in heaven, and felt a clear joy of us coming back. So we spend our whole lives, every day really, with that pattern. We don't spend our whole entire day in continual scripture study or prayer. We live life in the world, amongst the world, amongst others in the world, and so naturally our minds are pulled away. So we pull away and we get distracted. We don't ever have to commit any grievous sin, a serious transgression, to find ourselves feeling separated from the Lord. It can happen just over a prolonged period of time of maybe not giving it as much focus as you should have. You feel distant. We've all been there. I'm talking to you about charity today. When you hear the word term charity, you often think about in the context of our responsibility, really the mandate really that we've been given to share our charity towards others. I want to talk about it in a different light though today. I want to talk about the incredible importance of learning to accept and experience and feel the love of Christ that he has for us individually. And it's really only when we're able to allow ourselves to do that, to feel that love that the Savior has for us, and then turn around and in effect feel that love for ourselves, that we're really most or better able to share that charity and share that love for Christ with other people. It feels a little bit contradictory to me, a little bit, to talk about charity and then include the term self in that discussion, because as all of you have experienced, service in the Lord's kingdom has nothing to do with yourself. It has everything to do with everybody else. We're told very clearly what the Lord's standard is. Another scriptural passage in Mark 8. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples, also he said unto them, whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. He gives another response to another man in Luke 9. It seems harsh. And Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. This man simply expressed that he wanted to, yeah, I'll follow you, Lord, but maybe we'll say goodbye to my family first. I have to believe there's more to this passage of scripture than I think the Lord sensed in that man's response. It's not clear in the scripture. I think he knew the man's heart. And I think he sensed a complete non-commitment. And that's what he was referring to when he gave his statement to this man. I have to believe that maybe the man's response was something along the lines of, I'll follow you. Let me first go say goodbye to my family, and I'll be right back. There seems such an incongruency in that scripture when I read the Lord's response to that man who just went to say goodbye to his family. I think there's more to it. But there is a message to be learned from. That is, when you make a commitment, we are to commit with all of our hearts. And the Lord very clearly expects that. That clear expectation is made very clear with the rich man who he asked to sell all of his belongings and everything that he had and give that to the poor. So, what of ourselves are we asked to forget? I think that's also very clear in Scripture. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are expected to set aside our natural man. Hosea chapter 3. For the natural man is an enemy to God, as Scripture we are very familiar with. And God has been from the fall of Adam, and has been from the fall of Adam, and will be forever and ever, unless he yields to the enticing of the Holy Spirit, and putteth off the natural man, and becometh a saint through the atonement of Christ the Lord, and becometh as a child, submissive, meek, humble, patient, full of love, willing to submit to all things which the Lord seeth fit to inflict upon him, even as a child does submit to his father. So as disciples of Jesus Christ, we are clearly expected to forget ourselves, okay, and to lose ourselves in his work. But what makes up ourselves is more than just our bodies, is more than just our carnal flesh, it's more than just our natural man. At the core of who we are is a fragment. It's a vibrant and sensitive spirit being that we are never expected to forget. In fact, I have the full confidence. I think the Lord would expect us to nourish and strengthen and love, be patient with that spirit that we all have inside. That's an integral part of our makeup. We are never expected to forget that, as we serve others. The Lord wants us to feed our spirits, give our spirits continued nourishment. And even in the act of serving others, and our fellow brothers and sisters, our spirits are strengthened. This pursuit to put off the natural man, to begin our carnal lust and yield to the enticing of the spirit, really requires a daily effort. It requires pretty much continual thought. And a constant seeking to align our wills with our Father in heavens. Someone once said in a really brilliant statement that really our will in our hearts is really all that is truly ours and really have to give to the Lord. My wife and I reading this great book called The Continuous Atonement, written by Brad Wilcox. And in it, he discusses this very thing. For as many as there are who reject him, referring to the Savior, there are others who stay true. In the hearts of many faithful disciples, there is no question why or whether they need Christ. Their private doubt is whether he needs them. The firstborn in the premortal existence, the creator of the universe, the worker of miracles, and greatest of all, does he need them? He does. For members of Christ's church, the bread of sacrament represents Christ's body, the water his blood. But without us, those emblems merely sit in trays. We must pick them up and put them inside. We must internalize Jesus' offering. That's how we thank Jesus for all he has done. By accepting his love, remembering his sacrifice, and applying the teachings and atonement in our lives. Christ's gifts are freely given, but they must also be freely received. Mistakenly, we think that Jesus has everything, but he doesn't. He doesn't have you, and he doesn't have me, and not until we give ourselves to him. Elder Bruce C. Hafen wrote, "The Lord cannot save us without our own good faith effort. No matter how much he would give to make us his, he not only would not, he cannot control us against our will." And then finally, Neil A. Maxwell said, "The submission of one's will is really the only uniquely personal thing we have to place on God's altar." So I want to revisit a few of the lessons that we learned from the story of the prodigal son. First, it's very clear that Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ, loved us with a very pure love. And through the atonement of Jesus Christ, and through that pure love, we can expect the same warm welcome that the prodigal son received in that story. Not only as a one-time event at the end of our lives, but even daily, sometimes even multiple times a day, any time we make a decision to return from seeking the natural man and submitting our will to him. Second lesson, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we should extend the same love and forgiveness to any of our fellow brothers and sisters who may have strayed and are wanting to come back. We need to be careful not to judge them because they sin differently than us. they finally, one of the, maybe a little more severe lesson, maybe one that's taken for granted, or maybe even overlooked, is the lesson that we learned from the prodigal son's actions himself. And that simply is that none of the above things could have happened if he had not fully accepted and received the love that his father had to offer him. And this allowed him to be loving and accepting of himself, be patient with himself. So it's allowed him to get on the road. Get on the road in the first place, even come home. Make that decision to face his father. And apologize. How much sense would it have made if he would have, after returning home, and have had his father offer him a new coat, put a ring on his finger, a new pair of shoes, and even the fatted calf? How much sense would it have made if he would have rejected those offerings and then just immediately retreated to the pig trough, eat the slop that was offered to the pigs, as you remember he once wished to eat of one of the persons he was working for because he was so hungry? How much sense would that have made? Who really do that? Well, people do it every day. Every single one of us in this room has done that at some point in our life. We make ourselves content with the slop that's meant intended for the pigs. Anytime we allow ourselves to set aside the blessings that the Lord has for us, they really in any capacity. It doesn't have to be a big blessing to eternal marriage. It can be just a simple blessing of peace. If we set that aside, pursue worldly things, pursue our own carnal lusts and desires, we're guilty of that. We may do this as any time we're tempted to listen to the problems of the adversary, as he whispers in our ears and would have us judge ourselves harshly, or see ourselves in a light of with self-disdain or disgust. When we listen to those problems and let ourselves feel really discouraged and in despair, those are not the problems and the whispering of the Spirit. Anytime you're feeling that, you feel those feelings that make you just feel like giving up and question why things are worth it, pay attention to the source of those problems, because they're not from the Lord. All of us have had a time when we have either sat in the bishop's office, been on our knees at home in our bedroom, praying to the Lord, feeling godly sorrow for things that we've done. Every single one of us has had the experience of sitting in sacrament meeting, in particular sacrament, and have those same feelings and those same realizations. And there is not one time in my memory when I have come before the Lord in that state, or when I have walked out of a bishop's office, where I have not felt anything but uplifted and encouraged and loved and really hopeful. Tomorrow's going to be better than now, and yesterday for sure. Those are the feelings that the Lord wants us to feel. The Lord has rich blessings in store for us. And it's really up to us to make a decision whether we want to accept it or not. And then simply act in whatever capacity we're able to. And then enjoy watching the blessings flow, because they will come. We've all experienced them. In summary, charity is the pure love of Christ. We will best be able to share that pure love of Christ only after we have allowed ourselves to experience it ourselves and to feel those same feelings of love and patience and understanding toward ourselves. Man will be much better able to share that love with others, because it will be a well that will be coming from within. And it will just happen naturally. You'll see someone having eaten, just you will become, just watch them sit down and watch them have that eat. You will feel anxious to fulfill that need for them. As disciples of Jesus Christ, we are expected to set aside the natural man and yield to the enticement of the Holy Spirit. It's important to remember, as we strive to do this, to be loving and accepting and patient with ourselves, realizing that we're going to make mistakes. And then finally, the Lord has rich blessings in store for us. And these blessings can be realized only if we freely choose to accept them, to be humble, to be repentant, and to take full advantage of the atonement of Jesus Christ. And I say these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.